Well, welcome to Parkview, everybody. We're glad you guys are here to worship with us today. Let's stand together. Come on. I believe there is one salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. I believe in the crucifixion. By his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his life is testified. Come on, all praise. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty
Spirit. everyone. Hope you're doing well. Go ahead and grab a seat. We're going to continue to sing together here in a few moments. Just want to welcome you. We're so glad you made it this weekend. Those of you online, we're also glad that you're here as well. My name's Chad. I'm the campus pastor here at our Orland location. God has overcome, right? That's what we just sang about. We believe that's true. No matter what doubt you carry, no matter what challenge you're facing, no matter where you have failed, Jesus loves you. He has overcome the death and the grave. And we have a future with him. So that's why we're here. That's why we celebrate. And I'm glad that we get to do that with you this weekend. Last weekend, we had a student rally across all of our campuses for 6th through 12th graders. 450 students showed up. How cool is that? We're so excited about that. Man, we get to love on students and provide opportunities for them to connect with God. And so much of that is because you continue to be generous. So thank you for being that kind of church. We love to help students figure out who they are. And not just who they are, but who they are in Christ. That's a really big deal to us. And so I'm thankful that we get to provide opportunities like that for them. Coming up, Saturday, April 20th, is another opportunity for students 6th through 12th grade. We're going to be doing a serving project, partnering with Feed My Starving Children. A great chance for them to live outside of themselves and help a lot of families who are in need. And so I want to invite you, if you're a parent or if you're a student right now, this is a great chance to register. You even get community service hours if you're in high school. Take note, it's an opportunity for you. Don't miss that. Saturday, April 20th, we will provide transportation to and from that event, so don't miss out on that. And then we're going to do something new in the next several weeks, over the next 30 days actually. We're doing this thing called the Story Drive, and here's what we're going to ask. If you have been baptized in the past, and you would like to share your story about how baptism has changed your life, we're looking to capture 99 of those stories to share with our entire community when we do Baptism Weekend coming up in May. And as I say that, you're probably like, well, I enjoyed baptism, but my story's not that big of a deal. Let me just say this. It actually is a really big deal, and we'd love to hear about it. We've created a tool right on our website for you to go out. It's very easy to do. You can share your story with us and help us populate the story so that we can have a fantastic experience in May when we do that baptism weekend. Don't miss out on that. God has been faithful to us. He is worthy of his worship because he's always been faithful, and we get to continue to worship him for being that kind of God to us. So let's stand up together and continue to worship our God.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful. Still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I built my life on Jesus, and he's never let me down. He's faithful in every season.
I know the author. God, we thank you for this time, this space that we have, that we can sing a song of praise that says that we trust you in every season of our lives, God, that we can trust that you are there and that we can build our life's firm foundation upon that truth. We pray that you be with the rest of the words that are here spoken today. In your name, amen. You can have a seat.
Well, hello, Parkview.
Hey, welcome out. Glad you're here. Welcome out to the weekend experience, wherever you're tuning in from, whether you're online, one of our locations, or if you're in overflow today, we're glad you're with us. A little reminder for those of you that are sitting here as this room is starting to fill up. We do have Saturday services. We would love to invite you to. We've got a little bit of room still in that service, and then when it fills up, we will launch another Saturday service. And so help us out with that as we're filling up. Parking lot's getting full, which is awesome. People are coming to church. What an amazing thing. But my hope is that you'll join us on Saturday so we can create room for people that are still coming who want to know about Jesus. Amen? So help us out with that. But today, we are going to be in the next part of our series, The Problem of God. And I'm really excited about this week, mostly because I'm not preaching. We actually have a guest speaker today, and I'm really excited to introduce you to him. His name is Mark Clark, and he is the author of the book, The Problem of God. He flew in from California to be with us today and actually gave up a very large church experience this week at his church to preach to be here with us. And so it's a huge deal, but he is an author, a church planter, a writer, speaker for conferences, and a dear friend of mine. And I would love if you would give a warm Parkview welcome to Pastor Mark Clark.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. All right. Oh, my goodness. How y'all doing, Parkview? You good? You are blessed to have Ted. You are blessed to have Amy. These guys are the best. And I am so excited for your future as a church. Good to be with you. Yeah, live in California now. But I grew up in Toronto, Canada. Any Canadians in the house? No. All right, good. So it's great, guys. Thanks for coming out. But then I lived in Vancouver, Canada, the west coast of Canada, for 18 years. And man, here's the thing. The Problem of God, this is a series book I wrote 4 or 5 years ago, and your whole series is built on it. So what a privilege and honor to be able to speak here week 2 on science and the existence of God. And if you are a skeptic and you're here, a special welcome to you, because sometimes maybe you haven't felt comfortable in church. That was me growing up. I didn't grow up going to church at all. In fact, the first time I ever walked into a church was I was 19 years old. So the only reason I stayed is because there was pretty girls there, right? Can I get an amen? All right, from the youth section. I was like, I showed up. I didn't want anything to do with church because in my mind, church was like, everyone was going to be 200 years old. It was going to smell like mothballs. And it was going to be orange, shaggy carpet. And the first church I ever showed up to, it was exactly like that. But there were pretty girls there. And so I said, praise Jesus, I'm into church now. So, but if you are skeptical, if you're wondering, if you're new to this thing, and maybe you're exploring, we're glad you're here. And that is my story. I mean, not having come to the church when I was 19, I actually feel probably more comfortable hanging out with you if you're here and you're a skeptic than I do Christians. I don't always understand Christians. They're kind of weird sometimes. So when I first started going to church, like they'd be like, hey, welcome to our fellowship. I'm like, what are you, a hobbit? What do you mean, why do you talk like this? What is a fellowship? I don't understand. So my dad was such like an atheist. Like he was against Christianity. So we had no church, no Bible, nothing growing up. To the point where my mom said she wanted to name my brother Matthew, and my dad said, absolutely not, because that's a Bible name. So that's how against Christianity he was. 4 years later, they had me and named me Mark. So clearly this guy had never picked up a Bible before in his life. My middle name is Andrew. My brother's middle name is James. So we have 4 disciples just knocked out, and this guy's clueless. So that was kind of my life growing up in the skeptical world. And then God, weirdly enough, so a guy kind of told me about Jesus. And because I'm an evidential thinker, he told me about it in woodworking class in high school. And so I started exploring Christianity, like from a philosophical, scientific, evidential, historical vantage point. Not just, I never wanted to just believe something just because someone said you should believe it. I wanted to believe it because it was legitimate. And as I started to explore it, I began realizing that belief in God and Christianity was the best idea in the marketplace of ideas. So I gave my life to Christ, and I just started digging into it. And I was going to go into the film industry. I wanted to go do all that. And then God called me to go into pastoring. And I was like, oh no, I don't want to do that. Because here's the thing I know. People are the worst. Right? Like, people are the worst. Y'all are. And so I'm going to become a pastor. And everyone's going to be like, hey, send an email. Oh, the music was too loud. Start a singles ministry. It's like, figure your own life out. So I didn't want to become a pastor, right? I wanted to just deal with the academic world and deal with footnotes and people were just like, and then God's like, not only do I want you to become a pastor, once I moved to Vancouver, I lived in Vancouver for a bunch of years at that point, he's like, I want you to plant a church. And I was like, oh no. And it was like, here's 16 people, start a church from scratch. And I was like, well, there's lots of churches, right? And I'm living in like post-Christian, West Coast, progressive, Canada is at least a generation ahead of you guys in regard to secularization as a culture, right? So I like to say when I'm talking to American audiences, I come to you from the future of where your country is going in regard to secular thinking, all religious. So post, but this is the West Coast side of it. So progressive, hippie, like vibes. And so now I got to start a church, and they already think that they're connected to the universe because they wear Lululemon pants and eat kale and carry a water bottle or whatever. So they're like, I don't need this in my life. And so I'm going to start a church like that. So every week I just started, and everybody said, well, no one in Canada is going to want to hear that they're sinful and hear about the Bible and Jesus. So you got to just like make it all soft and chill. Like, hey, you're here and you have ideas. That's great. And I have some ideas too. I'm glad you're here. Sorry. You know, we're all just going to have this Canadian conversation. So I was like, that sounds like the worst church ever. So I just started preaching through books of the Bible, like verse by verse. It took me 3.5 years to preach through the Gospel of Matthew at our church. 3.5 years. So it was like, and I would just be like, guys, listen, you need to stop trying to be the hero of your own life and give your life to Jesus. And they would go, I'd say the one common denominator in your life, in all the disaster, is you. You are sinful, you are narcissistic, you are turned in on yourself, and you need to give your life to Jesus. And they would go, this is so offensive. I'm gonna go get my friends, all right? And so they'd get their friends, and their friends would show up and meet Jesus, and they'd get off their addictions, and their life would be changed, and their family life would be changed. And God just started moving and doing this crazy thing. And the 16 became 50, became 200, became 400, became 600. And then we ran out of space, so then we had to go to 2 services, which then people started coming up to me going, we shouldn't go to 2 services as a church. I'm like, why? I'm like, well, because then this one lady, she said, well, we're gonna lose community. I came here because I can meet up with Sarah after the service and we could go for lunch, and now who knows where? And I said, what? So then I got up the next week and I said, listen, guys, we're going to 2 services because I didn't start a church so that you could get more friends. I started a church because every single day, people like my father die and go to hell. So next week, we're going to 2 services. You can go to any other church if you want. I don't really care. We're going to 2 services. And just by going to 2 services, we grew by 50 people. Well, she left. So 49 people in a week. In a week. And then the church just started to go and go and go. And God showed up and did some crazy stuff and changed people's lives. And thousands and thousands of people in post-Christian Canada literally came to know Jesus, got baptized. We had campuses that went from coast to coast, all because God decided to use a moron like me. And I say moron because that's a Bible word. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 says, I'm going to use the foolish things of the world, and that's the Greek word moron. So you can embrace it for yourself, all right? But some of you, why that's important is because some of you are sitting here right now and you're like, God could never use somebody like me. And that's why I'm a skeptic still. You don't know, Mark, what I did last night. You don't know what I looked at last week. You don't know how I've derailed my life. You don't know what I've done with my family. You don't know what I've done with my finances. And some of you are feeling like you're the kind of people God could never use to change the world. And I am here because I'm the poster boy of God could never use me. Literally, when my parents got divorced when I was about 8 years old, I developed something called Tourette's syndrome, right? So when I'm a kid, that's why when I'm up here, I twitch my face around, I do weird noises. It's like I got Tourette's when I was a kid, and I'm like, and I guess God just has decided not to heal me from it. He just likes watching me. It's just like, right? So when you're growing up, when you have Tourette's, the thing about Tourette's is, like the thing about is you, like, if you've ever seen someone, they swear, right? So that was me growing up. Like I would sit at bus stops. I would like F. At, like not the letter, but the word F, right? Like you're nice Christian people. So here's the one job you're never gonna get in life if you randomly throw F-bombs around. A preacher! Right? It's not gonna work. Welcome to Parkview. F! Go get in a small group. So it's like, it ain't gonna work. And yet, here's what I've learned. God used me in that moment in Canada, not because of me, but in spite of me. And that's what he's gonna do in your life if you open yourself up to it. Literally, there's no reason I should have this job. I went to Starbucks the other day, literally I walked in, two people from my church, like, oh, Pastor Mark, we're from your church. Oh man, we're just so glad. And I felt a sneeze coming on. So I was like, achoo-choo. And then I kind of walked back and they stared at me and they didn't even say God bless you because they thought it was my Tourette's, right? It's like, this is the last person God is going to use to put up on a stage every single week to explain the Bible to people. And yet, God has done so because he sees fit to take the foolish things of the world and make himself look big. And that's what every single one of your lives can be. If you go, I'm gonna be open to this. What is God wanna do in my life? And so that's what we're gonna do. Now, as we talk about the question of science and the existence of God, we're gonna try to rip through a bunch of content. But I'll say this, as a skeptic growing up, what I thought about science and the existence of God was, in my mind, science was what smart people believed. And faith in God and the existence of God in Christianity is what stupid people believe, right? That was my exposure. So I would like turn on CNN, sitting there growing up in a non-Christian family, and it was like just watching the news, and it was like, tonight we're gonna debate science and faith in God. And on the side of science, we have Dr. Richard Dawkins, right? And he's all smart and like he has a British accent, like paleontologist, Darwinian sociologist, historian of science from Oxford. Hello, everybody. I will talk to you about science. And then on the side of faith in God, we have Joe. And Joe lives in a swamp and thinks Oprah's the Antichrist. I'll stab you, all right? And it's like, gosh, this is not a fair fight. And what I began to realize was that is all a facade. So the first thing we got to do is we have to confront the myth. Confront the myth that science is somehow opposed to faith. And it's not. All through history, you gotta understand, there's a whole story out there in history that Christians have always hated science. Christians have been opposed to science. Anytime a scientific discovery comes up, so that's where we get all these stories about, you know, when Copernicus or Galileo or Newton or whatever was coming up with stuff, the church was scared. And they burned them at the stake and they excommunicated them from the church and they silenced them and they wouldn't let them tell their story. You know, when they, Copernicus, hey, heliocentric view of our solar system, the sun is in the center, we all, no, the church freaked out because the earth has to be the center because we're the most important. And so they cast them out and they burned them and they persecuted them. And then all these, the flat earth, right? Oh, the Bible says that there's four corners of the earth. And so Christians thought it was flat. And so when someone said, no, it's round, they went, man, they burned them at the stake. Now, some of you, listen, no one ever thought the earth was flat for the last 4,000 years. The Greeks, it's only since the internet got popular that people are back thinking the earth is flat, all right? talking about morons. So there's, everybody knew the Greeks would watch a ship go off in the distance and the hull would disappear before the mast of the ship. There was a recognition scientifically. All of this story about the church is afraid of science is false. In fact, the university itself is a 12th century Christian invention. Harvard University was founded with the motto for Christ and the church. The church has never been afraid of science. In fact, Paul, in Romans chapter 1, here's what Paul says. He says, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen being understood from what? From what has been made so that people are without excuse." So Paul, right from the beginning, goes, we can figure things out about God by looking at what is made. We can study it. We can do the scientific inquiry. And here's the thing. Science has never deduced something about reality that has said, ergo, God does not exist. It's never happened. The reason is because science deals in the realm of what's called physics, and the question of God is what is called a metaphysical question. So physics, metaphysics. So metaphysics is the word meta in the Greek is the word after or beyond. So when you're dealing in the world of physics, you're looking at soil and stars and people, that's that, and you can deduce things about the world. What you can't deduce is metaphysical things. I'm gonna study physics and then deduce that there's no God. No, because God isn't part of the universe in the way that we think, okay, if we study this, now we're gonna be able to put it through the scientific method and have a conclusion at the end. That's not the way God is. God's a metaphysical person. And so he's outside the world of physics. So when I talk to my skeptical friends and family and I tell them about Jesus and they're like, yeah, I don't believe in God. Why? Well, I can't see him. What? What do you mean? What? That was a tick. Thanks for laughing. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Why would you expect to understand something about the metaphysics? Like, we're doing physics. That's like saying, what does the color green smell like? It's a category mistake to say, I studied this and I deduced something about the non-existence of God. Now, we're gonna talk in a second about how it can point to the actual existence of God, but science can never deduce anything about the non-existence of God. So Alistair McGrath says this, the idea that science and religion are in perpetual conflict, this is an Oxford scholar, is no longer taken seriously by any major historian of science. One of the last bastions of atheism survives only at the popular level, namely the myth that an atheistic, fact-based science is permanently at war with a faith-based religion. It's not true. And the reason it's not true is because the more and more science has delved into physics, the more it actually starts to legitimize the question of the existence of God, the more it actually starts to point to the existence of God. Now, here's why. So in the classic old models of science, like when you're talking to a skeptic and they're saying, well, science, 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 usually what they mean is like the classic David Hume 18th century, 19th century version of science, which is what's called observational science. It's like Darwinian, like you go into the Galapagos Islands, you look at turtles and you look at birds and you crack their wings open and you poke around and you're like, okay, I am deducing a lot of things about what I'm observing and I'm writing books about it. That's observational science. Here's the thing. Over the last 100 years, even the last 50, we have learned that the universe is far more complicated than we ever thought it was for the last 300 years. The universe, Darwin didn't know anything about DNA, for instance. He didn't know anything about going in and going, oh, there's a genome inside a DNA that has all this information. He didn't know about quarks and dark matter and string theory. Have you guys Googled string theory recently? If you wanna have nightmares. Guys, the universe is crazy. There's stuff that happens at one side of the universe and then it's happening at the other and it seems connected and things are appearing and disappearing at the same time. You can play, I was watching one documentary where it was playing music to water and it was calculating the molecules of the water. And when it played like nice Mozart music, the water was like dancing and clear. And then it played like ska music, like, and the water went all and curled in on itself. Water! Guys, there is an unbelievable amount of science that goes on. Now, here's the thing. The deeper and more complex we learn about the universe, the more we begin to learn that God, you need an intelligent mind, the more complex a system is. So nature, what nature tends to do is set up patterns, but it doesn't set up code. But if you and I were to look at certain examples and go, okay, if we were to go, if I was walking, this is the philosopher named William Paley pointed this out a couple hundred years ago. He said, if you're walking along the beach and you stumble upon a rock, you're gonna pick up that rock and go, okay, where did it come from? What brought it here? Well, it's probably, you know, a volcano went off 1,000 years ago. Not very complex. But if you keep walking and you pick up a watch and you look at the watch in the intricate details of how the mechanics of it work, you're going to begin to go, what created this? Well, not nature. Nature by itself could never create this. So there's probably, what? A mind behind it. And it's the same when if you were to walk around and just go through an ancient site and see a wall, you go, okay, well, that's nature. But if you went in and there was hieroglyphics and stories and languages, when you look at the pyramids and you realize the pyramids are actually built in a way that connects to the stars, you begin to go, wow, a mind built those. They sat down, they did mathematical equations, people, and it's so complex that when you watch documentaries or whatever, usually what do people say? Who came and helped the Egyptians build the pyramids? Aliens, right? It's always aliens. It's like there's no way they could have figured this out and moved all those rocks and done all those math. They must have had help. An intelligent mind and power came and helped the Egyptians build those things. This is what begins to happen. We begin to look at complex systems and we begin to deduce, man, there's actually pointers to an intelligent mind that is needed in the world. And so where does this lead us? It leads us to the point where we begin to understand that God is the mind behind some of this complexity. So the existence of God can't be kind of walked away from by physics, but physics and science can actually start to point to the existence of God. So let me talk about three ways that science begins to give us evidence for the existence of God. First is the question of morality. Okay, this is a little bit more of a philosophical one, but we'll start here. So morality was one of the reasons I ever became a Christian in the first place. So I'm 19, guy comes to talk to me about Jesus. I start studying philosophy, I start reading C.S. Lewis. C.S. Lewis, Oxford professor, in his 40s, begins to realize that maybe God is a real thing because he begins to realize that human beings are very moral creatures. So how many of us in here recognize that there is a right and there is a wrong? Raise your hand up if you believe there's right and wrong, right? So raise your hand if you think murder is wrong. Okay, good. People are like, woot. So murder's wrong, right? And we know that. And so what begins to happen is we have to ask the question, if we're really people who are wrestling with the real big things of the universe, why do I know that there's a difference between right and wrong? And every good answer that people think is good actually falls apart outside of God being an absolute moral giver, gave you a law built inside of you, Romans 2, that tells you this is right and wrong. Anything outside of that comes down to people going, well, there is no right and wrong. So I have this conversation with all my non-Christian family and friends all the time. They go, Mark, you say there's right and wrong, so I should believe in God. But there is no right and wrong. There's just what you believe is right. And what he believes is right is different than what you believe is right. And it's mean of you to project that on him, right? That's what people think. And so, you know, your culture believes this, your culture, don't project your values on me. And whenever I get in that conversation with people, I just want to flick them in the throat. And when they go, hey, why did you do that? I go, hey, bro, don't project your values on me, all right? I like to flick people in the throat. You don't like to flick people in the throat. What? My morality is my morality. What's your morality? It doesn't matter. Don't project your objective moral. Anytime someone begins to say that there's no such thing as objective moral values, that you gotta realize, guys, all of our life is built on the fact that there's right and wrong. Listen to your kids talk, okay? I have three daughters, 17, 15, 13. So I have four mothers at home. And at every moment, they're telling me what to do. This is right, this is, and they're arguing with themselves. This is what Lewis started to realize. Listen to a child. You have that orange. I want this orange. My kids, you jump on the trampoline. I get to jump on the trampoline. You got to go out last night, so I get to go out last night. All of our whole conversation is built on a shared morality, right? If you go to, how many of you guys fly Southwest? Right, Southwest Airlines, right? So the thing about Southwest is you don't get a seat assigned to you. You just show up. You have a number, so you get in the line. Well, if you ever doubt whether we believe in morals, just listen to these people argue about what number they are, right? Literally 2 days ago, I'm like in the line. The guy's like, what number are you? I'm like, A5. He's like, well, I'm A4. What? What? I'm A4, you're A5. Where's your wife? Oh, I got a wife. Well, where's she? Oh, she's back in C3. Well, you better keep her there. Shut up! If you ever doubt morality, just watch people in a lineup at Southwest. What? Cut off somebody in the grocery line and figure out whether they believe in justice, whether they believe in right and wrong. It's built into us. We believe in right and wrong. And here's the thing. The minute you begin to say, okay, there are objective moral values, then you have to have an objective moral law giver who gave you those laws, say, here's right, here's wrong, and you begin to chase those to the existence of God. So secondly, other than morality, secondly, is biology. And as we've delved more and more into biology, we've begun to realize that the existence of God makes more and more sense in one particular way. So if you look at human beings at a cellular level, you begin to realize that in every cell of a human being, there is an encyclopedia, 1,000 encyclopedias worth of information in every single cell. The human person is made up of 36 trillion cells. And in every one of them, there is a code, like a mind that built it and said, you're gonna have blonde hair, you're gonna have blonde hair, you're gonna have brown hair, you're gonna have blue eyes, you're gonna have, you know, you, and this is gonna be your personality, and this is who you are, and this is, and it's all built into, it's coded, like a mind built a code into the human genome, to the point where Dr. Francis Collins, who mapped out the entire human genome in the 90s, wrote a book at the end calling it The Language of God, because he began to realize there's something behind the code. 36 trillion cells, codes in everyone, defines everything. Now, if you don't want to believe in God, and you were to say, what's with all this cellular data? Why does this seem to be a mind that created it? It's literally a language. It's a language mapped out. Well, who created it? If people don't want to believe in it, and you go on the internet and you say, okay, all this information, and I don't want to believe it, what's the best explanation? The explanation that rises to the top? Aliens! Right? It's a theory called panspermia. It's that, yes, the code is there. It's kind of crazy. We don't know what to do about it. We don't want to believe in God, so we're going to say that aliens came down, stitched the genetic code, put it into the water, and watched it evolve over millions of years, and they're watching us and they visit. Now, the problem is, who created the aliens? And now we're back to square one, right? So all of this information, all of the code keeps pointing to the existence of God. Now, if I can just like preach to you for a quick second, here's the beautiful part. Guys, you have 36 trillion cells that make you up. This is what God was doing when it says, in your mother's womb, I stitched you together. You, Paul, Chris, Joanne, Sarah, you, and not the person beside you, you, with all your hair and your eye color and your personality, all the stuff I wanted to give you, that's how important you are to me. That's how much I love you. That's how much I'm building you, which means I don't want you to compare yourself to anybody else. Because the minute you start to compare yourself to other people, I want to be like them. I want to be like the guy beside me. And you scroll Instagram and you start to see the way other people live. The number one thing that destroys your contentment in life is comparison. You're not content in your marriage. I'll tell you why. Because you scroll Instagram and you look at them. And you go, why aren't my kids like that? Why isn't my husband like that? Why isn't my wife like that? And you start to compare and compare and compare, and you forget God wired you to be you and all your quirks and your nonsense and your past and the way that you look. Listen, do you know how often I am tempted to try to be somebody else? You think I could be like Ted? I'm not that smart. I'm not that organized. Listen, I was working at this church. It was my first sermon. So I was there and I had showed up at the church. And I was a smoking kid, right? I smoked since I was grade 8. So I show up, I got my big chain and my baggy pants because I don't want anyone to steal my $5. And I'm like, every church service, I would like go outside and I'd hide from the church and go and have a cigarette. And I didn't realize I was sitting in the back of the church. There's this big window and it was like a double reflection so I couldn't see in. But I guess it was the senior pastor's office and he had the whole worship team in there all the time. So I'm like, so they all started to like lose this kid. But after like a year or so, the youth pastor walked up to me. He's like, bro, I want you to preach. I'm like, okay. And then, so I started preaching a bit and then I got this job at this other church and it was one of my first weekends there. And they said, we want you to preach on a Sunday. And I'm like, okay, cool. It's a great opportunity, very humbled. And so they said, but here's our style. Here's what we do. We tell a joke at the beginning of the sermon. So the first thing that happens is we walk out and we look at the congregation, we tell a joke. And I'm like, well, that's not really my style. Like, what do you mean a joke? Like I have to look up a joke and then like, and they're like, yeah. It like calms everyone down and brings down their defenses. And I'm like, I don't really think this is me. And they're like, no, this is what we do. So I'm like, all right. So I got up on that weekend. I said, two Jews and a hooker walk into a bar. And like after that first service, you know, we went back in the room. They're like, you know what? Don't worry about the joke. We're good. Yeah, you do you, you do. But this is the point. It's like, God has wired you to be you, to be you, to be you, not anybody else. Right down to the cellular level. That's how much he loves you. 36 trillion times 1,000 encyclopedias of information in you because he made you. And that's why he wanted to redeem you. And that's why he became a human being, a biological creature himself named Jesus, lived a perfect life in your place, died on a cross for your sin, rose again for your salvation so he could save you. This whole thing, it's not about your neighbor. It's not about your grandkid. It's not about this friend that you're thinking of right now who needs to listen to this. It's you. And God is going, are you willing to open yourself up to what I want to do in your life? Third thing, okay, preaching over. Back to the data. Last thing is cosmology. So you have the argument from morality, you have the argument from biology, and you have the argument from cosmology. And it's pretty basic. It's that when you look, Immanuel Kant, the great philosopher, said there are two major arguments for the existence of God, the moral law within and the starry hosts above. When you look at the stars and the planets and how they function and how they ever came into existence, this is one of the great reasons people actually believe in God from a scientific level. And here's why. If you rewind the clock back 3,000 years and you look at all the philosophers that would talk about how anything came into existence, existentialism back then, Plato, Aristotle, Socrates, everyone believed in something called contingency, which was if something begins to exist, it has to have a cause. Right? We can agree to that. If you can prove that something began to exist, not that it exists, but it began to exist, then it has to have a cause. It's called causality or contingency. You in this room, you exist, right? You're conscious, you're here. Why? Because your parents before you existed, and one night they weren't in a fight, and now you exist. All right? The mood was right, and now you're here because people outside of you who predated you, there was an action that caused an effect. So everyone believes if something begins to exist, but then they would argue and they'd say, well, there's no need to believe in God because the universe is the infinite, uncaused, non-contingent reality that exists. You don't need God because the universe has always existed. And that was a really good argument back then until 1929, when Edwin Hubble, looking through his telescope, made a deduction that has been called the greatest scientific discovery of the modern era. And it was that the universe began to exist. He began exploring how all of the planets and galaxies, we're one galaxy in the midst of hundreds of millions of galaxies, infinite, was all going outward. Everything was moving apart. And as it was moving apart, it was moving back, not like into space. Now here's something for you. Space itself was moving. What? And when he started to do the math and move, how do all these things are moving apart? If you start to extract it back, he said about 15 billion years ago, there was a moment where all time, energy, matter began to exist in a single moment of explosion, to which Genesis 1 says, in the beginning, God made the heavens and the earth. All matter, light, time, energy. And it's amazing. In the beginning, meaning God is saying time is beginning now. Time itself is beginning right now. And so the universe begins to expand. So here's how Francis Collins tells the story. He says, some galaxies were millions of light years away. Hubble noticed that planets and entire galaxies were hurtling away from one another at fantastic speeds. Moreover, space itself seemed to be getting bigger. The universe was not expanding into background space. Incredibly, space itself was expanding along with the universe. Scientists realized right away that the galaxies were not flying apart because of some mysterious force thrusting them away from each other. Rather, they were moving apart because they were once flung apart by a primeval explosion. Here is the deduction. Logically, if you're a skeptic and you're here, here's what the Christian believes. It's not because they just want to believe it because it's fun and it's nice and it's sentimental and it helps them face death, which is the birth of all philosophy, our fear of death. It's not that. It's logical. Whatever begins to exist has to have a cause. The universe now, since 1929, we've realized the universe began to exist. Ergo, the universe has to have a cause outside of itself. That's why people believe in God. That's why people go, it actually makes more rational sense that God would exist. Now, here's the deal. Some of you are sitting here right now and you're like, I haven't understood a word you've said for the last 35 minutes, to be that honest with you. Where's Ted? And that's fair. But here's what you got to also know. Not everybody connects himself to a lot of this stuff, this data, this science. You know, I could get into the mathematical equations of the fact that the universe began to exist with 122 life-permitting variables, or the chances that it ever happening are 1 to the 10th to the 138th power, and how that's an astronomical number, and it's a miracle, the fact that the universe exists and that the Earth exists, and it's this far away from the sun and no closer and no further away, and carbon dioxide and levels of all of this crazy stuff that scientists and mathematicians look at and go, my gosh, there's a reason why most of the people who believe in God in university departments are more in the science departments than the social studies and humanities departments. It's because they're looking at the evidence all the time and going, man, now, for some of you, this is all like, I don't even care about any of this stuff. Can't wait till next week. But, I remember when I gave a talk like this at our church a few years ago, a guy named Paul walked up to me at the end and he said, listen, I'm an engineer. And every day I deal with math and I deal with science and I deal with the real world, and I've never really been into church before, because church to me was full of people who don't use their minds. It's full of people who are sentimental, traditional. And he goes, but listening to this talk today, what got me was the science and the math, and I want to give my life to Jesus. And he's crying at the front of our church. Now, that's not everybody. I get it. But some people, this is the beautiful thing. God has stitched himself into the universe to hint you toward himself. And the question is, are you going to go, okay, I will follow the evidence and then take the leap of faith, or will you just go, I don't like, a couple years ago, we're in bed, my wife and I, and all I hear is bam, and I woke up, and I'm like, oh my goodness, there's a massive explosion, what? And I looked over at my wife, I said, what was that? And she said, nothing. And then went back to sleep. Now, obviously, she was wrong, right? It was something. You don't just, in a similar way, the universe, bam, it explodes. You can't just say it's nothing. It's something. And I'm not saying I've said it's exactly, but it's something. It's nothing is what tired people say when they want to go back to sleep. And there are some people in our culture that are exactly like that. They want to look at all this evidence and all this thinking, and instead of leaning into it and going, maybe I'll do the difficult work, and maybe that's some of you right here, right now, you're like, you know what? Great stuff. Maybe God does exist, but don't let it change my Monday. I don't want to be different. My friends at work, they would laugh at me if I became a Christian. And at that moment, now we're in a space where maybe you're rejecting this, not because of the skepticism and the science, but because of cowardice that begins to get into our heart because we don't like change and we don't like what other people might think about us. And my prayer is you can fight that off and go, Lord, help me believe and help me with my unbelief. So I'll end this way. I'll tell you a quick story and then pray for you. My wife and I, a couple years ago, are driving up to Whistler, BC to do a marriage conference. And we're driving up there to teach 300 people how to have a good marriage. And of course, the principle for a pastor who's gonna spend his weekend telling people to have a good marriage is that I'm gonna have a bad marriage, okay? That's what's gonna happen. So we're driving up there, and she says to me, what are we gonna talk about at this retreat? And I said, which sounded really good in my brain at the time, let me do the teaching, and you can chime in every once in a while, okay? Yeah, so it sounded good, wasn't good. So at that moment, she goes, and does something that many men in this room might have experienced. She goes dead silent on me, and then just stares out the window. And so I'm driving up, and I'm like, oh boy, I don't know what to do about this. So I start to ask her questions to see if she still likes me. Hey, how was coffee the other day with Joanne or whatever? And she's not biting. So I just did something that I haven't done in a decade. I turned on the radio. Now, I was born in 1980. So it's like, I'm a Spotify guy, right? I choose my music, whatever I want. My channel, my music, I just did something. I thought, you know what? I'll just do it old school. I turned on the radio in my truck. Like there's space beams coming down into this antenna on the front of my truck. And I can't control it. And I'm not joking you. The first song out of the radio was the song that her and I danced to on our wedding night, right? Baby, you're all that I want. When I'm lying here in my arms, I'm finding it hard to believe we're in heaven, right? Yeah, come on. So I'm like, now first off, if you don't believe in God, the statistical odds of out of 500 million songs that exist in the universe, that the one playing at the time I most need it is the song that this is God reaching through the radio and just going, oh, come on, kids. I love you guys. Let's go. I need you guys. So I'm like, oh, gosh, honey, I'm sorry, man. Like, and I just see your arm come out from her angle and go boop and shut the radio off. I'm not joking. Cold. But that's the choice every single one of us has every moment of our life. As we walk through life, as we look at evidence, as we explore Christianity, as we explore God and how he hints at us and draws us and hunts us down. You know, the old hymn writers called him the hound of heaven, that he will hunt you down and give you things in your life. And the question is, are you paying attention to it? Are you willing to go, I'll respond to it, or I'm just going to continue going on with my life? So my prayer, God, is that we'd be the kind of people who would listen, who would hear, have our life changed because we are willing to burn away the cowardice, to have the courage to believe in you, Jesus, the one who died and rose again so that we might have eternal life with you, the one who can save us, seal us, encourage us, transform us at every level of our life, that you have given us evidence. You have not left us without things to trace down. You don't want us to just be people who feel things. You want us to think. You want us to love you with our whole heart and mind and soul and strength. And I pray that that is true about us in this room. And if there's people who need to give their life to you right now, maybe for the first time, that they would just say, Lord Jesus, I give my life to you right now. Change me. Not what I do, but what I want to do. I receive your grace. Change us. Let us be in awe, Lord, of what you have done and how you speak and preach to us every single day through what you've made. And let us not ignore it or shut our ears to it. In Jesus' great name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Aren't you glad you came this weekend? You know, we're going to take communion together. So I'm going to invite you to take those elements out. And as you do, you know, I was thinking back to that story he shared about him and his wife and about how God was reaching in and reminding him. And you know, we take communion every weekend. It's God's subtle way of reminding us, have you forgotten how much he loves you? And I just wonder, have you forgotten? The Bible says in Psalm 139 that we're fearfully and wonderfully made. So that means he knows everything about us, including our failure, our doubt, our worry, our fear, the things that we're not sure of yet. And in all of that, he's saying to us through communion that he loves us, to not forget that he died for us, to not forget that one day we have a future with him. So I want to invite us now to take a moment and just remember that. Maybe you need to ask for God's peace to come into your heart as we do this, but wherever you're at with him, I just want to give us a moment to just spend some time with him, give thanks, and then in a moment we'll take communion together. Friends, this is the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. Now the blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. Let's take a moment and pray together. Jesus, thank you for knowing us. The good things, the bad things, and everything in between. God, thank you that in spite of everything that goes on in our heart and our mind, you have died for our sin. You have promised that one day we will be with you. And so I pray, God, that as we leave this weekend, we would never forget that truth and that you'd help us to live courageously, following after you and loving the people around us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Before we head out this weekend, we would love to sing with you one more time. And as we do, there's some folks here who are going to take some steps in baptism. a fantastic opportunity for them to walk in their relationship with God. And so I'm going to invite us to stand up together as we witness and celebrate right along with them.
One salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. I believe in the crucifixion, by his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection, hallelujah, his life is testified. All praise to God the Father, all praise to Christ the Son, all praise to the Holy Spirit, our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore in Jesus' mighty name. I believe in the hope of heaven. He's preparing a place for me, far beyond what hearts imagine, ears have heard or eyes have seen. I believe that a day is coming, he's returning to claim his bride. Light the altar and keep it burning, see the Lamb who rose a roaring lion. All praise to God. To the Holy Spirit, our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name, I believe. I know I'm to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name, I believe. All praise to God our Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit.
Hey, we hope you've had a great weekend with us. Two quick things before you go. One, come back next weekend. We'd love to have you. Second of all, if you're ever interested in taking Next Step with God after service today, head out to our Next Steps area. Our team would love to meet you and help you along your way. As you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may he turn his face towards you and grant you peace this day and forevermore. Amen. Have a great weekend. See you next time.